let's look at the latest polling numbers now in the race for mayor. Mayor Joe Hogsett still with a significant lead, 57-23 here over Jim Merritt in the latest polling from IndyPolitics.org. Let's bring in our panel right now. I'm joined by conservative commentator Abdul-Hakim Shabazz from IndyPolitics.org and Jennifer Wagner, the former communications director for the Indiana Democrats. We're here as we set up for the debate on the West Side tomorrow night. Abdul, tell us about these polling numbers, not only that top line, a large lead for Mayor Hogsett. What else do you see in these polling numbers that gives you something to think about ahead of Election Day?
A couple things. We did our first poll back in August, and that sort of set the parameters. And then we pulled back again just this past week. I was amazed and surprised at how the numbers really hadn't changed all that much, even though our sample size was just a hair smaller than our original sample size. Number two, Joe Hogsett does very well in almost all and every township. Also, Joe Hogsett enjoys like almost 90% of the report support Democrats, while Jim Merritt is only about 65% of Republicans.
So you also polled specifically on the issue of crime.
On crime, it was a plurality. 40% thought the city was less safe than it was a year ago. The number for African Americans was almost 50. But for some reason, that hasn't quite been able to translate into smaller numbers by the mayor. He still enjoys a lot of African American support.
Jennifer, what do you make of this race and also everything we've seen here over the past few days getting kind of ugly?
It certainly is, and I think all along we've said that this was Mayor Hogsett's race to lose. He is not going to lose this race, no matter what happens tomorrow night on this stage. It would be very unlikely for him to lose based on these numbers and the trend. It's gotten really ugly, though, with the child support accusations and the black agenda debate between the two candidates that is playing out in my Facebook feed almost every day. It's gotten unnecessarily rough. I think this could have been a really above board campaign, kind of a highbrow campaign about the issues, and now it's just gotten silly.
Well, we're hoping to have a substantive conversation tomorrow night with the candidates.
If anybody can have a substantive conversation, my friend, it is.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. You as well. What are you expecting to hear from the candidates, considering everything that we've seen in the news here the past few days? What do you think it will be like here on the debate stage?
I think if you're the Hogsett people, it is do no harm. It's like, hey, you can see the light at the end of the tunnel. Hopefully it's not a train. Just, you know, get through that 30 minutes and be done with it. I think for Jim Merritt, for the people who are paying attention, this is maybe like your last best great stand to do something to change the dynamics. Now, I do think there is a path to victory still for Jim Merritt at this late in the game, and it really depends on turnout. Because
it has to be pretty low.
Pretty low. And sometimes the reverse of unintended consequence of polls like we did is a lot of people think, oh, no, that much of a lead is a shoo-in. No point coming out and staying home.
Let's also talk about the big story at the State House this past week, the Curtis Hill hearings. He took the stand in his own defense. A lot of ugly details that emerged here as well. Jennifer, I'll start with you. What were some of your big takeaways?
It just doesn't look good for Curtis Hill. The testimony was pretty grueling and pretty descriptive. I don't want to say what might happen in this case, because obviously it's up to Myra Selby, but it just didn't look good for him, and the fact that he still has his job is amazing to me.
Where is this headed, Abdul? Obviously, we don't know how long it will take for Myra Selby to reach a ruling here. Obviously, he could potentially lose his law license.
Right, and see, here's the thing. Myra Selby is not the final arbiter of what happens.
It could then go to the
Supreme Court will be have the final say. And they could do like, hey, because of your behavior, you're disbarred. Of course, I caution people, if this is now considered disbarment behavior, there'll be a whole lot of people losing their law licenses here in the state of Indiana. So the question is, how do you merit out justice? You know, send a message that this behavior is not tolerable, but also you don't want to necessarily open the floodgates. They have almost any lawyers left. What I worry about is if they do a suspension of his license, because under Indiana law, you must be a licensed attorney to be attorney general. If he's suspended, the question is how long? Is it a day? Then you have to step down. Is it 6 months that you can't be attorney general? Then we got an election.
Is it right up until the state convention next year? So Republicans can slot somebody else into that position?
Could be very interesting. We will see what happens. Obviously, a lot of very interesting news this past week in Washington, D.C., as well as the impeachment inquiry continues. President Trump still going back and forth with Democrats. A lot of news. Thursday, we heard from Indiana Congressman Andre Carson, who told CNN that the House Intelligence Committee will likely be holding public impeachment hearings in the near future.
At some point, we will have public hearings. The extent of those hearings has yet to be determined. But one thing is clear, the Intelligence Committee, the Oversight Committee, Foreign Affairs, we are doing our due diligence and making sure these depositions run smoothly.
Now, we also heard this week from Indiana Senator Todd Young about the latest news from Syria, the president announcing what he called a permanent ceasefire, though some remain skeptical.
Well, I think there are a lot of lessons to be learned from this. I thought we learned these lessons as a country when President Obama disengaged from Iraq, creating a vacuum, creating a terrorist activity in the wake of that vacuum.
A lot happening in Washington, D.C. Where is all of this headed, Abdul?
If I knew that, we'd be having this conversation in my island that I bought in the South Pacific, because I would have won the lottery by now.
But we saw everything, the protests in the SCIF this week. It was another wild week.
Yeah, and I think my Republican friends are making a mistake by attacking the process, because usually if you don't have the facts, you argue the process is unfair. This should be all out in the open. This should be public. And I think that is a mistake, because you never know what these people are going to say and what could possibly come out in public.
Also, it's about to be public, apparently.
It's about to be public, and that's what happened. Look, the Republicans are clinging to the last thing that they can object to, which is the process, because this week we had some pretty damning testimony from someone who is, you know, just widely regarded as a diplomat, someone who doesn't have any reason to lie. And it was pretty devastating.
And more testimony to come. Meantime, with everything happening in Washington, we're also hearing this week from one of the candidates seeking to replace Congresswoman Susan Brooks in Indiana's 5th District. This week, I spoke with one of the latest candidates to enter the race, Republican Beth Henderson.
A lot of people getting in this race, right? A crowded field so far.
Yeah. Well, we're excited about it. I'm very excited about it. I feel like I can be a strong representative with my background, and I really do care about this district. So we're going to press on, press forward, and we're hearing really exciting things about my campaign.
Could certainly be a very crowded primary there in the 5th District, already shaping up to be.
Well, let's put it this way. The running joke is, you know, when we talk about the 5th Congressional District, let's start with who's not running.
Right.
And because, please know, there's still time between now and, you know, January, February for somebody else to come crawling out of the woodwork here. I think what's interesting going to be seen, at least on the Republican side, is do people try to out-conservative each other and then sort of cannibalize that sort of far right or ideological base of the party, or do you find somebody who tries to be more moderate and maybe go for that part of the party as well?
Is this a race Democrats can win? I know Democrat Christina Hale has raised a lot of money so far.
I think it absolutely is, but I think we're going to have a crowded primary as well, and I think that's good. But, you know, former In Focus panelist Christina Hale seems to have the leg up right now.
Okay, thank you both so much. We'll be back for Winners and Losers in a few minutes. But up next, we're going to hear from Indianapolis voters. What do they think about the issues that matter most in our city? Kayla Sullivan explores that question after the break.